All right, so let's talk about artificial neural networks here. So we're going to talk about how it works in the brain and what deep learning is and how these things work out in practice. Biological neurons, the perceptron, boy, I remember this was the hotness back when I was doing this a couple decades ago, and various types of multilayer perceptrons. So in biology, these are artificial neural networks. They've been around for a long time, since the 40s, but they didn't accomplish much. Then in the 90s, we had new machine learning systems, but again, they didn't really accomplish too much. And now, finally, we're having another wave of interest as we're really getting significant accomplishments like the large language models, and people are really finding value in it now. So here's the case. You have a really large amount of data now available. You often need a lot of data. And for example, the large neural network models do require an enormous amount of English, and that wasn't really available until recently. They trained them on just a giant heap of data from the internet. And I see my Twitch getting very choppy here. I imagine I just have to refresh the page. That may happen to you as well. If there are any problems seeing or hearing me, let me know. Anyway, also in principle, you can have a theoretical problem we talked about before where you'd get stuck in a local minimum when you're trying to optimize something and not find it to the bottom. And that turned out not to be as common as people were afraid. And so now we have a self-reinforcing cycle where people bring in money and then they make progress and that brings in more money. So this is going to be the next tech boom, is all the stuff coming out of this neural networks, like previous booms, like the internet boom, and perhaps like the cryptocurrency boom, except that one didn't really lead to any actual valuable product, whereas artificial intelligence has already led to a lot of valuable products we're using all the time, from autocomplete in your text processor to the recommendations you're getting from Amazon and other stores. All these things are using it, so it's everywhere. So biological neurons have the nucleus and the cell body, and then they have dendrites, which are these short-range connections to nearby neurons to receive information from nearby neurons, and they combine the electrical signals or chemical signals that they're getting from all the neurons they're connected to nearby, and then they calculate an output, and when they reach a certain threshold, it fires, sending a signal down the axon, which is a long-range output. So they have many inputs, and they combine it all into one calculation and send one output. And that takes several milliseconds, like from 1 to 10 milliseconds. So your brain operates at, if you like, a clock rate of like 100 hertz. And yet it gets the job done. So the combination of many neurons working and only enough time to go through maybe 6 or 7 levels of calculation is enough to do amazing things like see and navigate the world and understand English with very low power. So those are called action potentials that go down the axon, and that releases neurotransmitters at the synapses, which then feed into another neuron. And you can grow them, and here's the kind of layout they really are, a sample of human cortex. You can see they have these short-range connections to things nearby and this long axon carrying the signal far away to the next stage of computation. So you can make simple on-off neurons, where all it does is have the output of this one goes into the next one, and when this gets a sufficient positive signal, it fires. So this is... C and A both have to be 1, if you think of them as 1 and 0. If they're both active, then you get an output that's active. Here you have A or B. A feeds in and B feeds in, and if either one of them is positive, then the output will come out positive. Here you get A intersect B. I think, yeah, they both feed in here. And I think there's an implied minus sign or something, so these have to, these will cancel out. I'm not quite sure I understand that one. Anyway, you can make simple logic gates out of these things, and I forget the details of exactly how that chart works, but it's not important. Here we're getting to the important one, which is the perceptron. This was developed in '57 also, And this is a simple computer analog of a neuron. So you have threshold logic units or linear threshold units. Now you compute a linear function of the input, and if you just leave it that way, where you just take the weight times the input plus the next weight times the next input and so on, and then an offset, that is the linear unit. But then you run it, and then you pass, if the linear is above some threshold, you fire, applying a step function to the result. So here is the TLU. It takes various data coming in, multiplies it by weights, adds them up, applies an offset, and then if the result is above a certain threshold, like zero, the output is one, otherwise the output is zero. And so you train it to adjust the weights and the bias to achieve whatever you want. And the perceptron is just a layer of threshold logic units. Every threshold logic unit is connected to every input with a fully connected layer. That's called the dense layer. And so you have the inputs here, and here's the outputs. And the output is just a linear calculation based on the inputs and run through a thresholding function. So this one here can classify instances into two classes. If X1 is high but X2 is not high, you'll get one output. If X1 and X2 are both high, you'll get a different pattern of output. If X2 is high and X1 is high, you'll get a different output. So you can, in principle, these inputs can go through some kind of calculation and fire three outputs. And so you could, in principle, sort two inputs into three outputs, although it's going to be very limited and inefficient here. What's much more efficient is to have a hidden layer of neurons in the middle, like we do. We've done it before. Say GPT training is -1 gigawatt. Right, the human brain uses 12 watts, GPT uses a gigawatt. Yes, exactly. So if we can move closer to the hardware in the brain, we could do this with a lot less power. So Hebb's learning is when a neuron triggers another neuron, often the connection between them gets stronger. So the weight goes up if this one's activated. Perceptrons also use the error of a prediction. That's feedback. If you know what the right answer is, you can feedback basically with, you know, as we said, supervised learning. You can feedback information whether you are right or wrong. And here's how we're going to train a perceptron. Stochastic gradient descent. We're going to take the next step's weight is equal to the previous weight plus the output. This is Hebbian learning. So if the output is larger than it was before, I think is the point, then you have increased the weight by some factor here. So you sort of dig a deeper groove for whatever you do. You learn from experience. And the point here is you think about something like human vision. Infants have pretty terrible vision, and then they learn, for example, binocular vision. So they learn that when one eye sees a dot, if the other eye sees a dot in the same place, then that is good. And we will learn to orient the eyes so that happens more often. So you can learn to have your eyes point the same direction for binocular vision. Even though nobody is telling you the right answer, you can do it just by correlating the outputs. So here's the limitation of perceptron. It's linear, so it cannot compute XOR. If you have X1 and X2 and you want this truth table, where if they're both low, the answer is zero, and if they're both high, the answer is zero, but if one is high and the other is low, the answer is one. That's a fundamentally nonlinear calculation, and you can't do it, but two layers of perceptron can do it. So you do it this way. Here's the weights are all one. So if you, and the bias is -3/2 and -1/2. So if you feed in one in both of these, then you'll get two coming in here, -3/2, and that will be a half coming out, so it will fire, and this will be a -1 going into there. If you feed these two ones in here, the bias is -1/2, so this will also, this will be +1/2, so it will go here. And you will have 1/2 here, -1/2, you'll have 1, and this will fire. So when both are high, it'll fire. And I feel like I didn't quite work that out right. I left some slides here to try to guide me. It's a little hard to explain. Let's see if I can get this one right. If they're both 0 at this level, then here, all these inputs are 0. So I have 0 plus 0, -3/2, that's -1/2. So the output is 0. It goes through a thresholder. If the output's below zero, it puts out zero. Then that zero, okay, this one here, I feed in two zeros, minus a half, again it's minus a half, again the output is zero. So at this layer, they're both zeros, and so here I get zero minus a half, so I get zero. So if I feed in zeros at the bottom, I get zero. Now if I feed in ones at the bottom, this is the one I tried to do and got wrong, then this is 1 plus 1 minus 3 halves, that's plus 0.5, so this is a 1, and this one is 1 plus 1 minus 1 half, so it's 1 and a half, so the output is 1, and when you feed the 1 and the minus 1 and the 1 here, this negative weight causes them to cancel out, and the minus a half causes it not to fire, so two 1s give you an output of 0. That's why two layers of these things can accomplish an XOR. Linear activation functions yield only linear models. Yes, exactly right. That's why you need this thresholding function here. This is called the activation function. This is the source of nonlinearity here, this step function. You do have to have a nonlinear function somewhere. All right, and if the two are different, like if this is 0 and that is 1, then I'll have 0 here but 1 here. Minus 3 halves is negative, so the output is 0. Here I will have 0 coming in and 1 coming in. Minus 1 half is plus a half, so the output is 1. So I have 0 here and 1 here. Minus a half, it's positive, so it puts out a 1. So 0 and 1 this way produce a 1, and 0 and 1 the other way similarly produce a 1. So that's how you create an XOR out of these things. So let's try a Kahoot, which is chapter 10A, and here it is.
So am I forgotten? How do I get access to Kahoot?
You go to Kahoot.it in a browser, and then you put in that number. Good, I see Mike made it. I'll wait till the end of the song. Like everybody's here. That'll do. Okay. All right, so what part of the neuron branches out to get signals from nearby neurons? That's a dendrite. All right. Someone says you can't hear the music, but if you can hear me, you should be able to hear the music. anyway. It should just be coming through my microphone, I think.
I suspect you have noise or background noise filtering.
That's probably it, yeah. So anyway, which one of these does binary classification? You're right. That's interesting. In class, the students hear it. So you guys don't hear the music at all. That's interesting. Oh, because probably because you're using Zoom. If you use the Kahoot sound, you'd hear it. That's why. It's Zoom that has that background filtering, I think. Anyway, that's a perceptron. All right. I think a TLU might be a good answer too, but anyway, all right.
Actually, I put perceptron and it marked me wrong, I think.
The what?
I thought I put perceptron and it marked it wrong.
Oh, well, maybe I am back. I wonder if there's any back, yeah.
I think it just showed TLU.
It was a TLU, I think. TLU is the right answer, because yeah, perceptron is overkill. All right, I got confused by that one, worrying about the sound. All right, it takes two of these to compute XOR. All right. Yeah, that's perceptron. Takes two of them, because you need three TLUs at least. You need two layers of TLUs. So that's two perceptrons. All right. These are always extra credit because they're a little bit unfair. Diana. All right, good. Anyway. All right. Yeah, so that's why people usually hear it. People are usually using the Twitch sound, and the Twitch sound picks it up. The Zoom sound must be suppressing it. That's understandable. All right. Anyway, so the multi-layer perceptron and backpropagation, this is really the main exciting thing here, I think. So here's your multi-layer perceptron. You feed inputs. You perform a linear calculation on them with weights here in the hidden layer, and then you add up all the input signals with the weights and compare it to a threshold output function. This is nonlinearity. And then you feed that into here, which does the same thing at the output layer. This is a feed-forward neural network. Signal goes only one direction. You have input, goes to the hidden layer, that goes to the output layer, and that's it. And you can have a deep stack of these, like multiple hidden layers, and that's called a deep neural network. But in 1970, this technique was developed to figure out how to do gradient descent. The only thing I knew when I did this is if you have a bunch of parameters, there's a weight everywhere these things go in. So there can be hundreds of parameters. And the only way I knew to optimize it is to try like 10 values for each of those hundreds of parameters and try to find the smallest among them. That's the grid search. And that rapidly becomes impossible with a lot of parameters. But the smarter way is to do reverse mode autodifferentiation. What you do is you take the output and then you analytically can calculate the derivative based on all these weights, and you can analytically calculate how much the output depends on this weight and how much it depends on that weight through derivatives, assuming that you have not a step function here but something smoother. So then you assume local linearity. And approximating all these functions as locally linear, you can say, how much would a small change in this weight affect the output? And you can do that for every weight, and you can deduce a vector, which is in what direction in this high-dimensional space would I go to lower the error? That is an achievable problem, and that's what's happening in these gradient descent algorithms. And what you do, this is called reverse mode autodiff, you use reverse mode autodifferentiation to figure out which direction would cause the error to decrease, assuming local linearity, and then you take a step in that direction. And that's called backpropagation. And that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing with all these models. That's where it had 500 epochs. It was just taking a step in the direction that it estimates is the direction that will lower the error. All right. And it can calculate the gradient by going one pass forward and one pass backward. It can get enough information to calculate that partial derivative on all those variables. And that's what works. You initially start with random values of the weights. Then you use a mini batch. Most people recommend 32 instances. Then you run the batch through to the end, keeping all the calculated values. And they call this a tape in the Python libraries. So it keeps a record of all the values. Then you measure the error. And then you take all those values to analytically calculate the contribution of each weight to the error, and therefore which alteration in the weight would cause the error to go down. And now you can perform a gradient descent step in that direction. So you can't use a step function, or there wouldn't be any gradient anywhere. You have to have something smoother. So the heavy side is this step function. And you can't use something smoother. There's a variety of functions. You can do this one with exponentiation or a hyperbolic tangent or a variety of things. But you just want something that smooths it out. And here's the rectified linear function, where you just have zero and then you add a straight line here. The red one. Yep, it's just flat and then it's straight line above that point. That's the simplest to calculate. But any of these will do in most cases. But you don't want this one here that has a discontinuity in the derivative, because everything relies on the thing being linear for small perturbations. So you have to have some kind of gradient here. So that's the game. And so now you can predict a value. If you want to predict one value with one output neuron, you have the inputs, a hidden layer, and one output. If you want to predict a 2D value, you just need two output neurons, like we did when we were sorting things into 10 classes of fashion clothes and stuff. You can do this for x and y for a two-dimensional value. And so you have to choose the activation function. If you could leave the output unchanged and not put it through an activation function at all, or you can guarantee a positive value with some of these that don't let it go below zero. There's a variety of them. All right. Now you have to have a measurement of error, right? You have to measure the output and measure the error, and then figure out what direction will lower the error. So as I said before, usually you take the mean squared error when fitting some kind of data points. If you have a lot of outliers, then you use absolute error, or perhaps Huber loss, which combines these two if there's a parameter to adjust it. All right, so here's what you typically use. 1 to 5 hidden layers, 10 to 100 neurons per layer, one output neuron per output value you want to achieve, want to find. Usually you use this rectified linear activation function for the hidden neurons, and for the output activation, either none, so you just get a raw signal, and you choose, say, the highest signal as a classification, or you can use this if you want positive outputs, or this if you want bounded outputs. And there's a loss function, mean squared error typically, or the Huber function, which mixes mean squared error and sum of absolute value error if you have a lot of outliers. So those are the recommended for regression, fitting curves. And for classification, for binary classification, you only need one output neuron and a sigmoid activation function. So high values mean yes and low values mean no, that sort of thing. For multi-label classification, you have multiple output layers, and if you have the ability for two of them to be true, like spam and urgent, then they just have outputs, so the probabilities are positive in both cases. If you have only one result allowed, like that classification case where we had 10 different clothing items and you only want one of them, then you use this thing called the softmax function that will scale the output so the total of all of them is always one. So they're basically percentages. And that's how softmax works. This is a vector containing the scores. So you take e to the score and sum by the total e to the score. So it's pretty obvious it will normalize it. So if you add up all the scores, the result will be 1. And so for classification, you typically have this 1 to 5 hidden layers, one output neuron, or one per binary label, or one per class in these different choices, and sigmoid here, because you just want a signal, and it doesn't have to be normalized. And here you would use softmax to make sure that the total of all the outputs adds up to one, so you can treat them as a percentage. And your loss function would be cross entropy here, which we talked about before. It takes that whole table of errors and figures out how many errors there are in all the different categories, how many type ones are misidentified as type two and type three and so on, and combines them with a logarithm function to give you an entropy measure. Just a number to see how wrong you are. And here it is, cross entropy is the sum of the target probability times the log of the predicted probability. But anyway, that's the this is something that will just give you a number that combines all the types of errors to give you a entropy that is high if you have a lot of errors and low if you have less errors. Or perhaps I got that backwards. Yeah, no, it's high if you have a lot of errors and you try to minimize this function. All right, so let's take a look at 10b. All right. On, you can't hear the sound. Interesting.
A lot of systems have canceling music modes as well too.
Oh. Yeah, well, I know this one's important because otherwise people get like echoes if they don't use headsets. So I've noticed that I
hear it fine on Twitch, Sam.
Yeah, if you listen on Twitch, you'll hear it. Yeah. But the Zoom, I know, has this echo suppression, which is good because otherwise I couldn't do what I'm doing here. I wondered how that worked when I started doing this. I thought I would have to wear headphones, but the other people's voices in Zoom do not enter my microphone and echo. And that's clearly because of that suppression.
I'm sorry.
Music what?
Like you were muted for a moment.
Oh no. I don't think so. I'm just waiting for people to come in. I guess I got what we're gonna get. I'll carry on. All right, so what was the method from 1970 to make gradient descent possible, really? Yep, that's the reverse mode autodiff I was just describing. All right, so what's the measure of loss that works best for multi-label classification? That's cross entropy. It's just as well you can't hear the music. It's glitching again anyway. All right, so what function makes sure that the total of all the outputs is one? That's Softmax. All right. All right. So, to implement these things with the Keras library, we did this in 101 with the 28 by 28 grayscale images of clothing. And so you load the data set using this data set load data. That'll load it from the images. It easily breaks it into training set and test sets. And then you divide by 255 to normalize it. So the brightness value goes from 0 to 1 instead of 0 to 255. Sequential makes a usual model where you have a layer feeding to another layer and another layer, what we talked about there, a feed-forward network. And so the flatten layer takes the input shape of 28 by 28 and turns that into a one-dimensional list of 784 values. The dense layer means each one of those is connected to each one of these with a weight that can be adjusted. And the next dense layer means each of those 300 is connected to each of these 100 with weights. And the last dense layer is the output layer. So each of these 100 feeds into each of these 10 with weights. And the activation of these 10 will light up to indicate the various output categories. And that's why you use softmax at the end to make the total output normalized so it will add up to 1. So we already did it, but now I think the explanation explains a lot more about what we're doing here. The input comes here, the pixels, the two hidden layers, and then the outputs. And so there's a whole lot of weights being adjusted to make it work. And this is how it works. Your input layer has no parameters, but then it feeds into this dense layer. And so this has 784 times 300 parameters, plus I think one plus 300 for an offset. And here you'll have 300 times 100 plus an extra 100. That's this 30,100. And here you'll have 100 times 10 plus an extra 10 for the offset. So that's 10. So you get the total number of parameters. All right. So you compile the model. And you choose the error measure. Should be cross entropy. Here's stochastic gradient descent, which we talked about using backpropagation. And the default learning rate is 0.01. You can specify it, but the default works here. And your metric will be accuracy during training and evaluation. That's what you're going to report. So then you do a fit. It will fit. Here's the number of epochs it will fit for. Here's the training data and the validation data. So it shows the accuracy on the training set and the validation data. Here's the training set, and here's the test set categorical out, actually down here, I think. I'm not quite sure which one is which. All right. And when you're done, this one is the, that's right, this is the training data and this is the test data. That's what I thought, because that's what you end up. The training data is better than the test data, and that's what you'd naturally expect. And we saw this learning curves before with epoch. So the loss will go down, and the validation loss should also go down. But at some point, you start overtraining. So the training loss gets below the validation loss. So beyond this epoch of 10 or so, you're overtraining, not really training to the meaningful part of the data again. Why sparse again? Sparse? What was sparse? Oh, sparse categorical accuracy. Good question. I don't know why it's sparse. Sparse normally refers to an array where most of the elements are zero. I don't know why it calls this sparse. It's a good question. I don't have a good answer. All right. So to improve performance, you can try adjusting the learning rate, number of layers, neurons per layer, and activation function, that sort of thing. you can have wide and deep neural networks where you have, for example, if you think about the thing where you're categorizing numbers, then there probably are some areas where if there's just light in those neurons, that tells you something. For example, if there's light in the upper left corner, then it's got to be an 8 or a 9 and not a 1. There probably are some input layers that could be used directly for output without having to go through intermediate processing. And then some of it you have to go through processing because it's more complicated than that. And so this way you allow you call this wide. It's not just sequential. There's a second path that's also included here, so you can include things that do not pass through this processing. So that's deep patterns and simple rules, both can be included. That's a wide and deep network. This is deep, this is wide. And so you can create that here. Instead of having sequential layers, you just specify the layers. You got normalization. Here's your dense layers, here's the concatenate in order, another dense, and you put them in order with concat down here instead of with sequential. And now you can have your output layer include both the normalized and the hidden layer, so it includes data that's zipped past the hidden layers and some that's gone through the hidden layers. That's how you create this in Keras. You can also have multiple inputs. You could have two inputs that take a different path towards the output, and you can model things like that. You can have multiple outputs. You might have two different things you want to measure. It's fun to play with, can show the entire network weights as they're training. Playground, let's take a look at that. There was something like this, but I don't think it looked this good in the textbook. Yeah, it's good. Yeah, it looks quite valuable. Actually, let me see if I can save this this link. That looks like a good thing to add to the course. The Neural Network Playground. Very good. All right. And so multiple outputs is another possibility if you have some secondary thing you're trying to measure from the data. All right, and you can also make models that are more complicated than this, including things like for statements and if loops, where sometimes it goes through certain layers and sometimes it skips over certain layers. And this tensor board is what they talked about in the textbook to be a visualizable model. It looks a lot less fun than your playground, however. And so, the hyperparameters, there's a lot of them, number of layers, activation functions, and so on. And so you can do grid search and randomized search to try to optimize these parameters, where it'll try various values. And you can also integrate it with that graphical thing, tensor board, to try to find them. And so in principle, one hidden layer should be enough, but in practice, more hidden layers tend to work out better. You can make a model with less total parameters and get the job done. This is probably why our brain has several layers. And the idea, which is definitely the idea for the brain and the idea that they have for neural models, is that the lower level layer would look at low-level things, like just little line segments and the edges of things for vision, and then higher levels would look for longer-range features. There are people that believe the brain works that way, and people that believe neural networks work that way, and in both cases, it tends to be an oversimplification, not that easy. But you can do this, which suggests there's some truth in it. You can start from pre-trained lower levels. So you could train a visual model on pictures of any type, and then reuse those trained layers on pictures of a different type. Because the low levels have learned something very simple, like just detecting an edge or a bright spot, and that would apply to almost anything in the high level. So this is what happens. You don't bother training all the layers from scratch. You reuse a pre-trained network that performs a similar task. And this is, of course, absolutely how large language models work. You start with a model that was trained on billions of pages of data from the internet, so it learns language, and then you give it a little bit of tuning for your company data on top of that. All right, and so number of neurons, the hidden input and output layers are set by the problem. The old-fashioned way, again trying to model the what they thought the human brain was like, you'd have more neurons at the lower layer and less at the higher layer, because you'd think of it as doing larger scale calculations at the higher level. But nowadays, people find the same number of neurons in each level tends to be the more popular way to do it these days. All right. And there's this thing called stretch pants, where you use more layers of neurons than you need and use regularization to prevent excessive overfitting, like early stopping we talked about before, where you're doing some kind of gradient descent, and as soon as it gets worse, you stop. All right. Learning rate is the most important hyperparameter. And if the learning rate is seen as too big, it will never converge. If it's too small, it will make too slow convergence. So there are plans to train it at one model and just keep increasing the rate. And you'll find a rate when it's the loss starts to rise. That's when it's too big. So you raise it until it's too big, and then go down to 1/10 of that. That's one way to find a good learning rate. So there's optimizer, there's batch size. People work with batches of data, not all the data. You can play with the activation function, you can play with the number of iterations, or you can just use early stopping. These are other ways to smooth your model. So let's look at the last Kahoot, and that'll be the last lecture for today, which is 10C.
Your Kahoot pass numbers remind me of phone numbers I used to memorize.
Yeah. They vary in length. Sometimes they're only 4 or 5 digits long.
Oh, so far they've all been 7, which has always been somebody's phone number.
Yeah. Well, they might have changed it. It used to be you would get really short numbers sometimes. That space in the middle, I think that might be new too, and that's a very good idea.
I remember letters. Pennsylvania 65,000.
Well, yes. Letters to numbers on the phone dial are a very strange transformation. It's not unique. Like base 64 is not unique either. I'll wait a few more seconds, I guess.
I wonder if Kahoot ever brings up a code of 8674309. Was that the number?
You know, that number works. That number
that
works.
Number on the wall.
Yeah, that number works for loyalty programs. Also, the Microsoft main contact number. That's what I use at Safeway.
Okay.
I recommend this for privacy. I learned that at DEF CON. And then when I went to like Lucky's, it wouldn't take it, but it took Jenny's number, the one you just so. So how do you turn a two-dimensional image into a one-dimensional list? That's flatten. That's a good name. Describes what it does. All right, so which model have only one set of layers connected sequentially? Oh, okay. All right, that's a deep neural network. That's what's deep about it. It has to go through all those stages. Which method uses early layers that were trained on a previous task? All right, that's transfer learning. All right. Stop that one.